From Pacifica, this is Democracy Now!
We are a nation of laws. And as I have said, as we have said, from day one, that those laws apply to everybody in our country. And that includes the President of the United States.
The Ninth Circuit has unanimously refused to reinstate President Trump's executive order temporarily banning people from seven Muslim-majority countries from entering the United States. The ruling comes less than 2 weeks after Trump signed the order, sparking protests across the country. We'll get reaction from Vince Warren, executive director of the Center for Constitutional Rights. Then to Phoenix, where the mother of two U.S.-born children at the center of an immigration fight has been deported to Mexico.
Arpaio.
Arpaio.
Yo fui víctima de Arpaio.
Arpaio, Arpaio. I was the victim of former County Sheriff Joe Arpaio. For them, I am a criminal. The simple fact that I work made me a criminal to them.
Guadalupe Garcia de Reyes was arrested and detained during her routine check-in after living in the United States for 21 years. Advocates say her arrest signals a shift in deportation priorities under Trump. We'll go to Arizona to speak with Reyes' husband and an activist who was among hundreds who tried to block her deportation. Then, the Bowling Green massacre.
I bet it's brand new information to people that President Obama had a 6-month ban on the Iraqi refugee program after two Iraqis came here to this country, were radicalized, and they were the masterminds behind the Bowling Green massacre. I mean, most people don't know that because it didn't get covered.
That's fake news. We'll speak with ProPublica reporter A.C. Thompson about his real news investigation, when the government really did fear a Bowling Green massacre from a white supremacist. All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. A federal appeals court in San Francisco has unanimously upheld a suspension of President Trump's executive order barring all refugees from entering the United States and restricting travel from seven Muslim-majority countries. Thursday's decision is a stinging blow to the Trump administration and appears headed for an appeal to the Supreme Court. President Trump responded to the ruling on Twitter, tweeting in all caps, "See you in court. The security of our nation is at stake." Unquote. In Washington state, the attorney general, who successfully challenged Trump's Muslim ban, Dan Ferguson, hailed the ruling.
This is a complete victory for the state of Washington. The Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals, in a unanimous decision, effectively granted everything we sought. We are a nation of laws. And as I have said, as we have said, from day one, that those laws apply to everybody in our country. And that includes the President of the United States.
In their unanimous decision, a three-judge panel in the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals ruled courts have the authority to review constitutional challenges to executive actions. The judges also said the government failed to show evidence that anyone from the seven nations cited by Trump's travel ban had committed terrorism in the U.S. If the case ends up in the Supreme Court, a potential 4-4 tie would leave the appeals court ruling in place. Meanwhile, at least one of the judges hearing Trump's travel ban has faced threats, prompting local police officers and the U.S. Marshals Service to beef up security. That's according to CNN, which cited unnamed law enforcement officials. After federal district judge James Robart issued a nationwide injunction last Friday halting Trump's executive order, Trump called Judge Robart a so-called judge and tweeted, quote, "Just cannot believe a judge would put our country in such peril. If something happens, blame him and court system. People pouring in bad," unquote, the president tweeted. Jeff Sessions has been sworn in as U.S. Attorney General. Vice President Mike Pence administered the oath of office to the longtime Alabama senator during a ceremony Thursday in the Oval Office. Afterwards, Sessions addressed reporters, promising to get tough on immigration, claiming terrorism and crime are surging nationwide.
"We have a crime problem. I wish the blip—I wish the rise that we're seeing in crime in America today were some sort of aberration or a blip. My best judgment having been involved in criminal law enforcement for many years, is that this is a dangerous, permanent trend that places the health and safety of the American people at risk.
In fact, FBI statistics show the homicide rate has fallen consistently and dramatically since the early 1990s, and property crimes are at a low not seen since the 1960s. Sessions' comments came after President Trump falsely claimed the U.S. murder rate is at its highest level in more than four decades. It's actually at one of its lowest points in the last half century. Immediately after swearing in Sessions as Attorney General, President Trump signed three new executive orders addressing crime and immigration.
Today's ceremony should be seen as a clear message to the gang members and drug dealers terrorizing innocent people. Your day is over. A new era of justice begins, and it begins right now.
One executive order seeks to increase penalties on those found guilty of assaulting police officers. A second order directs law enforcement agencies to increase intelligence sharing while going after drug cartels. A third order directs Attorney General Sessions to prioritize fighting illegal immigration, quote unquote, alongside drug trafficking and violent crime. In Los Angeles, scores of protesters marched through downtown and blocked a freeway entrance Thursday evening following reports of immigration raids across Southern California. Officials with ICE, the Immigration and Customs Enforcement, told reporters the agency was only conducting routine enforcement. But California State Senate President Kevin De Leon and the ACLU of Southern California report they've received reports of multiple raids of homes across Los Angeles. Meanwhile, the mother of two U.S.-born children, who's at the center of an immigration fight in Arizona, has been deported to Mexico. Guadalupe Garcia de Reyes was arrested and detained Wednesday during a routine check-in with immigration officials. She'd been living in the United States for the past 21 years. Garcia's teenage daughter and son reacted Thursday to the deportation.
I'm going to keep on fighting. I'm going to keep on fighting for my mom and for the other families that are going through the same thing, because this is unfair, and it's really sad.
We want her back in our arms. We want her back over here where she belongs. She belongs with us. And we're going to keep on fighting. We're not going to stop.
Reyes's rapid deportation after a routine check-in comes as thousands of immigrants around the country face similar check-ins. We'll have more on the case of Guadalupe Garcia and others after headlines. We'll speak with her husband. The White House is warning journalists and lawmakers against criticizing a botched raid by U.S. commandos on a Yemeni village last month that left 25 civilians and one U.S. Navy SEAL dead. The Bureau of Investigative Journalism reports the January 28th assault killed nine children under the age of 13, with five other children wounded. Among those critical of the raid was Arizona Republican Senator John McCain.
When you lose a $75 million airplane, and more importantly, American lives or life is lost and wounded, I don't believe that you can call it a success.
On Wednesday, White House Press Secretary Sean Spicer lashed out at Senator McCain and journalists for criticizing President Trump's decision to order the raid.
It's absolutely a success. And I think anyone who would suggest it's not a success does disservice to the life of Chief Ryan Owens. He fought knowing what was at stake in that mission. And anybody who would suggest otherwise doesn't fully appreciate how successful that mission was, what the information that they were able to retrieve was, and how that will help prevent future terrorist attacks. I understand that. I think my statement's very clear on that, Kristen. I think anybody who undermines the success of that raid owes an apology and a disservice to the life of Chief Owens.
Sean Spicer's comments came as the United Nations appealed for $2.1 billion in emergency aid to Yemen. The UN warns 12 million people face the threat of famine brought on by a U.S.-supported Saudi-led war and naval blockade. Back in Washington, D.C., the Senate confirmed Congressman Tom Price as President Trump's Health and Human Services Secretary this morning, following a debate that stretched well past midnight. The vote, 52-47, with all Republicans in support of Price and all Democrats and independents opposed. Price will lead Trump's campaign to repeal the Affordable Care Act, a well-known opponent of abortion, and for the defunding of Planned Parenthood. The White House says President Trump committed the U.S. to the so-called One China policy, in which the U.S. formally recognizes Taiwan as part of mainland China. Trump reportedly made the commitment during a phone call with the Chinese President Xi Jinping on Thursday. The move marks a reversal for Trump, who previously angered Chinese officials when he broke from decades of diplomatic precedent by speaking directly with Taiwan's president soon after his election. The Washington Post reports President Trump's national security adviser, Michael Flynn, privately spoke with Russia's ambassador about U.S. sanctions against Russia in the month before Donald Trump took office. The call was on December 29th, the same day President Obama imposed sanctions against Russia and expelled diplomats in retaliation for the alleged Russian hacking of the U.S. election. The Post report directly contradicts repeated claims by the Trump administration that such discussions took place and appears to run afoul of U.S. law. A spokesperson for Flynn backed away from past denial, saying, quote, "While Flynn had no recollection of discussing sanctions, he couldn't be certain that the topic never came up." Japanese Prime Minister Shinzo Abe is set to meet with President Trump at the White House later today. Tomorrow, the pair are scheduled to tee off together at the Trump International Golf Club in Palm Beach, Florida. Abe will also stay at the Trump-owned Mar-a-Lago resort. Ethics groups say the move to host Japan's leader at Trump properties is a clear conflict of interest. Meanwhile, Reuters reported Thursday that President Trump denounced a treaty limiting U.S. and Russian deployment of nuclear warheads as a bad deal for the United States during a call with Russian President Vladimir Putin. Reuters cited three unnamed officials with knowledge of the January 28th discussion, who said Putin asked Trump whether he favored extending the New START treaty, which was approved in 2010. Trump reportedly paused the discussion to ask his aides what the treaty was before telling Putin it was one of several bad deals negotiated by the Obama administration and that it favored Russia. Top lawmakers on the House Oversight Committee will order an ethics review of White House counselor Kellyanne Conway after she used a TV appearance to promote merchandise sold by President Trump's daughter, Ivanka. Conway made the endorsement on Thursday morning's edition of Fox and Friends.
30
seconds. Go buy Ivanka's stuff is what I would tell. I'm going to go get some on myself today. It's a wonderful line. I own some of it. I'm going to give a free commercial here. Go buy it today, everybody. You can find it online.
Conway's comment followed a tweet from President Trump's official government account Wednesday blasting the retailer Nordstrom for dropping Ivanka Trump's clothing line from its stores. Trump's tweet read, quote, "My daughter Ivanka has been treated so unfairly by Nordstrom. She's a great person, also always pushing me to do the right thing. Terrible," unquote. Kellyanne Conway's TV sales pitch is a clear violation of federal ethics law. The White House said it had counseled Conway over the endorsement, but declined to say if she would be sanctioned. House Oversight Committee Chair Jason Chaffetz, a Republican from Utah, said Thursday he'll ask the Office of Government Ethics to recommend Conway be disciplined. Chaffetz told reporters, quote, "That is absolutely wrong, wrong, wrong. It is over the top," he said about her comments. Meanwhile, Congressman Chaffetz was met with boos, jeers and pointed questions Thursday as more than 1,000 constituents packed a raucous town hall meeting in his Salt Lake City district.
Let me tell you something you're really not going to like. You want to hear this. Hold on. You're really not going to like this. The president, under the law, is exempt from the conflict of interest law.
Crowd members booed as Chaffetz took the stage. They chanted, "Let them in," as at least 1,000 more people were denied entrance to the packed high school auditorium. Protesters demanded Chaffetz launch ethics investigations into President Trump and other administration officials over numerous conflicts of interest. Other protesters called out Congressman Chaffetz over his support for selling off public lands in Utah and across the Southwest. In North Dakota, construction crews have resumed work on the final section of the Dakota Access Pipeline after the Trump administration granted an easement to allow Energy Transfer partners to drill beneath the Missouri River. The construction resumed as opponents of the pipeline filed a last-ditch legal challenge in a federal court in Washington, D.C. Thursday. They're seeking an order halting construction, while a separate lawsuit filed by the Standing Rock Sioux Tribe proceeds in court. U.S. District Judge James Boasberg says he'll hear arguments on the motion on Monday. In Syria, Russian airstrikes killed three Turkish soldiers and left 11 others injured in what Russia's military described as an errant strike aimed at Islamic State fighters. The attack came as Russian, Turkish and Syrian government forces advanced on the city of Al-Bab, which is controlled by ISIS. In South Africa, lawmakers traded punches on the floor of the parliament Thursday as opposition politicians denounced President Jacob Zuma over charges nepotism and mismanagement of the economy. The scene played out on national television as Zuma's opponents sought to interrupt his annual State of the Nation address. And longtime Puerto Rican independence activist Oscar Lopez Rivera was returned to the island of Puerto Rico on Thursday to serve the remainder of his sentence, which was commuted by outgoing President Barack Obama. His official date of clemency is May 17th. Chicago Congressmember Luis Gutierrez confirmed Thursday that Lopez Rivera has been moved from a prison in Terre Haute, Indiana. A spokesperson said in a statement that Gutierrez had, quote, led a small delegation on a flight that originated in Indianapolis, routed through Charlotte, and has landed in San Juan. And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. A three-judge panel on the Ninth U.S. Circuit Court of Appeals has unanimously refused to reinstate President Trump's executive order temporarily banning people from seven Muslim-majority countries from entering the United States. The ruling came less than 2 weeks after Trump signed the order, which sparked protests across the country. The judges wrote, quote, "The government has pointed to no evidence that any alien from any of the countries named in the order has perpetrated a terrorist attack in the United States." The judges went on to say, rather than present evidence to explain the need for the executive order, the government has taken the position that we must not review its decision at all. President Trump responded first on Twitter by writing a message in all caps reading, "See you in court. The security of our nation is at stake." Trump later briefly spoke to reporters at the White House.
It's a political decision. We're going to see them in court, and I look forward to doing it.
So you believe the judges made it?
We have a situation where the security of our country is at stake. And it's a very, very serious situation. So we look forward, as I just said, to seeing them in court.
Okay. Thanks, guys.
Do you think this has undercut the early days of your presidency? This is such a core issue.
No, this is just a decision that came down, but we're going to win the case.
The ruling was a major victory for the state of Washington, which took Trump to court. Washington State Attorney General Bob Ferguson called the ruling a victory for the U.S. Constitution.
We have seen him in court twice, and we're two for two. That's number one. And in my view, the future of the Constitution is at stake. That's at stake as well. And look, we respect that the president has broad authority when it comes to issuing executive orders, but they still have to follow the Constitution. The president does have a choice. He can continue to fight this, or he can tear up this executive order and start over. I would strongly encourage him to consider the latter course of action.
The Trump administration now has 14 days to ask the full Ninth Circuit to review the decision or appeal directly to the U.S. Supreme Court. Trump could also rewrite the executive order. Washington State Solicitor General Noah Purcell, who argued the case, welcomed the court's decision.
What we argued to the court yesterday was that it's the role of the courts to say what the law is and to serve as a check on the executive branch. And that's what the court has done in this opinion, in this excellent opinion, this well-reasoned, careful, thoughtful opinion that seriously considered all of the government's arguments and rejected them. This is not a partisan issue. The idea that the government does not get to just say that something is in the national security interest without sort of having to back that up in any way when they're violating people's rights.
Well, for more, we're joined by Vince Warren. He's the executive director of the Center for Constitutional Rights. Welcome to Democracy Now!
Thank you.
The significance of this decision that came down last night, Vince.
It's an extraordinary, extraordinary decision. This is what we were hoping for, where in light of President Trump trying to jam through all of these ill-considered, atrocious, unwarranted executive orders. We're trying to position the courts to have the final say on what his authority is and also the wisdom and veracity and legality of what he's trying to do. The court took a couple of very clear positions, which you've talked about, but I think they're significant. One is that the Trump administration took the position that this order was unreviewable by any federal court anywhere. That sounds a little bit like George Bush. It's because it comes out of the George Bush playbook. And in fact, when the Ninth Circuit answered that question and said, we certainly do have the authority to review these orders of the president. They cited our case, the Center for Constitutional Rights case, Boumediene versus Bush, which went to the Supreme Court for that very principle. The court did not take on the First Amendment claim of whether this was religious discrimination, but they really didn't have to, and primarily because the government put forward no evidence at all that this ban was related to terrorism coming from these seven countries. As you pointed out, zero evidence of any people coming from those countries committing terrorist attacks on U.S. soil. But what we do have evidence of is the thousands of people that were affected and negatively affected by this order. In fact, you know, the Center for Constitutional Rights filed a challenge with the Inspector General of the Department of Homeland Security where we laid out some of these horrible things that were going on. And people were brutalized, handcuffed, children handcuffed, people held without food and water for up to 18 hours, forcibly thrown back on airplanes. And in fact, many people had been trying to see lawyers in airports around the country, and Department of Homeland Security, Customs and Borders officials refused to let them see that. And in a couple of cases, people were forcibly made to sign away their visa rights that had been given by the government in order to be deported. I mean, this is the kind of outrageous stuff that happens when this narcissistic president.
And what does that mean when they have to sign away their visa rights?
So what happens is that the government, you apply for a visa, the government grants you a visa, you come into the country, you're supposed to be able to walk through with the vetting that they have. What it actually meant was now they're stuck at the airport, they are in detention, and in order to deport them, the Customs and Border officials made them sign a document that said, I renounce the rights that were granted to me under the U.S. government's visa program. And that then gives them an out. So they say, well, now that this person has renounced their visa, we're going to ship them back on a plane. And a number of people reported that this is what happened to them. That's deeply, deeply troubling.
And so now, when the ban has been stayed, they can't come back in?
Now that the ban has been stayed, that means that they actually can come back in.
Even though they waived away.
Well, that's going to be—this is the—for those people, they're going to have a problem now, because they're going to have to apply to this government's State Department now. I don't think this government's State Department is going to allow them to come back in, which is also troubling. So it's essentially one government lets them come in, the other government kicks them out and then doesn't let them come back in, even though their policy banning people from those countries is now frozen and blocked by courts.
During oral arguments, Justice Department lawyer August Flinchy questioned the role of the court in reviewing the president's actions.
The reason we sought immediate relief and a stay is because of the district court's decision overrides the president's national security judgment about the level of risk. And we've been talking about the level of risk that is acceptable. As soon as we are having that discussion, it should be acknowledged that the president is the official that is charged with making those judgments. I'd also like to
So are we back
talk briefly.
To you, I mean, are you arguing then that the president's decision in that regard is unreviewable?
Yes.
That was Tuesday night. Well, on Thursday night, after the court's ruling, Washington State Attorney Bob Ferguson responded to the government's claim.
Throughout this litigation, the president has asserted that his actions in signing this executive order are unreviewable. And you heard the question posed by the Ninth Circuit judges in the oral argument this week. The question was asked, is it the view of the Justice Department that those actions are unreviewable? And after a rather lengthy pause, the answer was yes. Here's what the Ninth Circuit had to say about that. There is no precedent to support this claimed unreviewability, which runs contrary to the fundamental structure of our constitutional democracy.
So that's Washington State Attorney General Bob Ferguson responding, Vince.
Yeah, you know, I think the Trump administration took that position for two reasons. One, we are in the age of the ever-expanding power of the presidency. Donald Trump's not the first president to take that position. That's happened before. The second reason why they took it is because there was no there there. They knew that if courts did review the evidence that they were putting forward, which was basically nothing, that the courts would be compelled to rule that this ban was not based on any useful evidence. You know, we have a regime of vetting visas from these seven countries, which had been heightened by Congress. And so the courts were asking during the hearing, well, what has changed or what is different that makes this type of ban, which is much more draconian and I think also is unconstitutional, what's the change that has made it different? And they don't have an answer to it. So it's a very significant view that a state has now asserted in federal court that what the president says just because he says it doesn't mean that everybody has to abide by it. People can interrogate that question. It's really significant.
The ruling notes, quote, "We cannot rely upon the government's contention that the executive order no longer applies to lawful permanent residents. Moreover, in light of the government's shifting interpretations of the executive order, we cannot say that the current interpretation by White House counsel, even if authoritative and binding, will persist past the immediate stage of these proceedings." Vince Warren, how do you interpret this?
Well, the court is sending a clear message that the evidence put forth by the government, as well as the different things that they were saying about this, you basically can't trust it. When courts say that we can't rely on an assertion, that essentially means that we can't trust what you're saying to be true, to be able to rely on it to build a ruling in your favor. What we had here is we had a blanket ban. They walked that back. Departmental officials started issuing communiques. Well, the ban doesn't apply to lawful permanent residents. The Customs and Border Patrol were throwing people that were lawful permanent residents out of the country at the same time that the administration was saying, no, they should come in. It was complete chaos. But I think more than that, it's really the veracity of this administration that's at stake. You know, John Crewe is a good friend of mine from the Bay Area, said that the problem isn't so much radical Islamic terrorism. The problem is radical narcissistic presidency. And that's really what the courts, and we're all feeling that. That's what the courts are saying, that a presidency that is so erratic, that is just throwing things together, can't possibly be the linchpin around which we're going to build our democratic values. It has to be pushed back, they have to be sanctioned, and they were.
So where does this go from here? Far be it for you to say what President Trump is going to do, but what are the paths he can take right now? He said, see you in court.
Yeah. There are a couple of paths that he can take. One path is that when they move for the emergency order to get rid of the block of the ban, they also filed an appeal in the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals. So what he could do is he could continue to argue that appeal in the Ninth Circuit. Now, what that means—
The complete Ninth Circuit.
The complete Ninth Circuit.
What that means— Which is what, like 27, 28
judges? It's a very large number of judges. And it's also—you have to apply to get that kind of hearing. That process can take a long time. And while that's happening, the ban is still in effect. He's also running the risk of losing again.
And the ban is not in effect.
I'm sorry, that the ban is not in effect,
right,
and that the stay is still in effect, so that he runs the risk of not having that ban in play during that whole period. He can take the case directly to the Supreme Court. You know, I'm not a betting man, particularly when it comes to this president, but that seems like, if you're tweeting in all caps, see you in court, that sounds like it might where it's going. They can go to the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court can hear the case and decide whether it wants to overturn the decision or not. Eventually, the case will go back, if he loses, the case goes back down to the district court, where they have an actual hearing with evidence on—
The district court is Judge Robart.
Judge Robart in Seattle, where they will have a hearing on the preliminary injunction, and that's a determination as to the temporary stay that the judge put on the ban. It's a hearing as to whether that should go for longer. So there are a number of options. It's hard to say where they're going to go, but it's clear that the administration is on the back foot here.
That's involving this case. There are other cases in courts, like one in Virginia, they're in Massachusetts. What happens with those?
Well, those cases are also proceeding, and I think what is happening now is that those courts are likely waiting to see what happens here, because Judge Robard put a blanket stay on the ban. That covers the entire country. The government was arguing that it was too broad, but right now there is a stay in the entire country. So other courts are waiting to see what happens. If it turns out that this stay from Judge Robart gets overturned for some reason, other courts can move in with different theories, with different sets of facts, and we might be able to see this all over again in different courts.
What about Donald Trump's comments about the judges, calling Robart a so-called judge, and then in the midst of these proceedings, as the three judges are deliberating, talking about the proceedings as being disgraceful? And now we hear, at least CNN reported, that at least one judge needs hyped-up security, needs more security because of threats.
It's troubling and it's disgraceful that the president of the United States can't abide by a process, a democratic process that's been around in this country for over 200 years. It also, frankly, smacks of authoritarianism. When you look back at regimes that have come to power, one of the things that they do is they try to make people afraid. So this whole Muslim terrorism thing is a tool to get people to be afraid. The next thing they do is they attack the press. The next thing that they do is they attack the courts. That's what we're seeing here. And, you know, this isn't over a 30-year regime. This is over 21 days we're seeing this. This is really problematic. And again, the biggest threat that we have right now is how this president operates within our democratic principles.
And the reports that Judge Gorsuch said in speaking to not only Connecticut, Connecticut Senator Blumenthal, but others, Republican and Democrat, talking about the attacks on judges as being demoralizing and disheartening. It's not, although President Trump said this was a lie, that this was misinformation, and so did his press spokesperson, Sean Spicer. Gorsuch's own transition team guide said he made these comments.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's—I mean, it's significant for a couple of reasons. One, I'm not a big fan of Neil Gorsuch. If Neil Gorsuch gets confirmed and goes to the Supreme Court, it's going to be a lot of bad news for the things that we care about. Nonetheless, one of the things about almost all federal judges, and particularly conservative judges, that they do have a sense of decorum and process. And we found this in the Bush administration when we were doing our cases on Guantanamo. There were certain things that even conservative judges can't abide. Unfortunately, they tend to care less about people's bodies and people's lives, whether they go to jail or they're trying to get abortions, but they care more about the decorum of the democratic principles and the role of the judiciary. So I'm not surprised that Neil Gorsuch said those things or feels those things. And frankly, as we go through the 4 years, even no matter what number of Republican judges that the administration puts in, he's going to have this problem.
Very quickly, what hasn't gotten as much attention, because this is so major, this continuation of the stay on the Muslim ban. On Thursday, President Trump signed three new executive orders addressing crime and immigration. One seeks to increase penalties on those found guilty of assaulting police officers. A second directs law enforcement agencies to increase intelligence sharing while going after drug cartels. And a third directs the attorney general, now Jeff Sessions, to prioritize fighting illegal immigration alongside drug trafficking and violent crime. Vince Warren.
Yeah, those three executive orders are pretty much right out of the National Fraternal Order of Police playbook. The sum total of those three orders means massive new resources going to law enforcement on the federal, state, and local level. The order that has to deal with police officers that you were mentioning really is the beginnings of what we're calling a Blue Lives Matter regime. We've been seeing this in states where there are increased penalties criminal penalties for assaulting, sometimes even insulting police officers. The idea that built on the idea that if you're black or if you're gay or if you're a woman and someone assaults you, that it is worse and there should be penalty enhancement for that. We're seeing that for police officers, which doesn't make sense. The other piece that I think is significant is in one of the executive orders that you mentioned, where the attorney general is to look at crime reduction. Crime is not going up it hasn't been going up for 30, 40 years. It's going down. The other part of that executive order was talking about restoring public safety, as if we don't have public safety now. But significantly, and you pointed this out, the Attorney General has to look at rising crime in three areas: drug trafficking, violent crime, and then illegal immigration. This is the first time that I have seen the status of being undocumented looked at as a crime that has to be reduced through enhanced punishment, through enhanced things like that. That's the big problem that we need to keep our eye on.
And that's what we're going to look at next. A woman who, in the midst of all this, who's lived here for 21 years, the mom of two American-born children in Arizona, was deported yesterday. We'll speak with her husband. Vince Warren, thanks so much for being with us, Executive Director of the Center for Constitutional Rights. We'll be back in a minute.
Dos, tres, cuatro.
Migrating Bird by Gabby Moreno here on Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. The mother of two U.S.-born children, who's at the center of an immigration fight in Arizona, has been deported to Mexico. Guadalupe Garcia de Reyes was arrested and detained Wednesday during a routine check-in with immigration officials. She'd been living in the United States for the past 21 years, but had been arrested in 2008 during a raid on a water park in Maricopa County and convicted of a felony for using forged documents in order to get a job. Advocates say her arrest signals a clear shift by the Trump administration to deport people who are considered a low priority for removal under President Obama. An executive order issued during the first week of his presidency vastly expanded those facing removal to include anyone found guilty of any offense, as well as accused of crimes but not convicted. Speaking from Mexico Thursday, Garcia said her problem started with the infamous Sheriff Joe Arpaio, a longtime supporter of Donald Trump.
Arpaio. 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 Yo fui víctima de Arpaio.
Arpaio, Arpaio. I was the victim of former County Sheriff Joe Arpaio. After following through with the process, all was good. I was given permission, I was working, and everything was going well. And then, with the check that was done, the felony that Arpaio gave me came back, which made me a criminal. For them, I am a criminal. The simple fact that I work made me a criminal to them. I don't think that is just. Imagine that I underwent a checkup every year, and they wait and they see that everything is good, and then they say no. They cannot give me permission that I will be arrested. They practically took away my right that I had before for the felony that I previously had.
Guadalupe Garcia's rapid deportation after a routine check-in comes as thousands of immigrants around the country face similar check-ins. On Wednesday, hundreds protested her removal by surrounding the van, carrying her away from the immigration office, where she was taken into custody. One man locked himself to the wheels of the van, while others blockaded it with their bodies.
Stopping the kidnapping of Lupita so that she can be with her family. I'm here because today it's Lupita, tomorrow it may be my mom, and the next day it might be your mom. We need to stop the deportations because there are 8 million people at risk. There are 8 million people who are a priority in the Trump administration, in the Trump deportation machine, and he's not going to stop it. We have to stop it in your city, here in Phoenix, wherever you are. You can do this too.
For more, we go to Phoenix, where we're joined by Aaron Reyes, who is the husband of Guadalupe Garcia de Reyes, who was just deported to Nogales, Mexico. His wife had been living in the United States for 21 years and leaves behind two teenage children who were also born in the United States. And we're joined by Francisca Porchas, the organizing director for Puente, Arizona, a grassroots human rights movement for migrant justice. She live streamed the protests on Wednesday as people tried to prevent the deportation van from moving forward. We welcome you both to Democracy Now. Let's begin with Aaron Reyes. Tell us your thoughts right now, where your wife is, where your children are.
Well, my wife and my children are at the border of Mexico, Nogales, Sonora.
And can you describe what happened on Wednesday? How did this all go down?
Well, she just went for a regular check-in, you know, with ICE. She's been doing this for the past 8 years. Every year, like, they will let her out. They say, okay, you're in good standards. You haven't done anything wrong with the law or anything. Just come back in a year. So last Wednesday, what happened is she went to a regular check-in, and they decided to arrest my wife because of their new Trump administration with his new laws that he's signed. She's a priority now, according to his new executive orders.
I mean, this was incredibly fast. She was arrested when she voluntarily went. I mean, she went for her annual check-in. She was arrested, and she was deported the next day.
Yes, that's what they did to my wife. I mean, this is just, like, shock for me. You know, it's shocking because, like, I mean, it is, I mean— Yeah, I have no words for it. It's just unbelievable.
I wanted to ask Francisca, you live streamed this whole thing, but you work on these issues every day with Puente, Arizona. Explain what were the grounds on which she was taken after being here for 21 years?
She has a felony conviction. She is, like she said in her interview, she's a victim of Arpaio. She, Arpaio, for a very long time, terrorized our folks, like, as you know. And he colluded with a very racist county prosecutor, a county attorney here, Bill Montgomery, who decided to give felonies, felony 4, 5, 6, to some of these folks caught up in workplace raids. He did 700 raids. He reported almost 700 people, did almost 90 raids, and so she is technically priority because she is a felony conviction. President Obama had stated that it was felons over families type thing, which we disagreed with. And so it's a very well-oiled machine that President Obama built, and now Trump is operating at 100 miles an hour.
So, can you explain what happened when she was arrested years ago? What was it, like 8 or 7 years ago? What was she arrested for at work? It was a workplace raid.
Yeah, so Arpaio went to the place where she worked and picked up a lot of people because they were working without proper documentation. She wasn't actually physically there, but he demanded all the paperwork of a lot of the people that were working there without paper. So it was actually a house raid. She was picked up for working without documentation. They showed up at her house very early in the morning and took her. And it was very traumatizing for the entire family. And so she spent a few months in detention and fought to be able to stay in this country. The case remained open, as many people whose cases are open right now, or some people, they have closed cases who are going to be reopened. And so ICE asked her to come back every single year to check in, just so that she wouldn't show that she wasn't fleeing. And so when she shows up this year, which is the 8th year, she was told that she could no longer go out on her own reconnaissance and continue to check in, and she was going to be apprehended and going to be put on deportation proceedings. And so we did a lot of work advocating for her on the outside. We also reached out to Senator McCain, congressional leaders, the mayor of her city. They all reached out. So even the tactics that I think have worked under President Obama before, with some pressure from both Republicans and Democrats, didn't work for her, even though she's, like, one of the most, quote-unquote, sympathetic immigrant cases.
So can you describe what you filmed, what you live streamed, the protest, and what happened to the protesters who attempted to stop the van she was in?
We knew that they were going to take her out. They had taken all day to actually give us any answers. And when they apprehended her, we knew that they were going to attempt to take her out because that's a processing center. It's not a jail. She couldn't spend the night. And so we sort of were waiting on every door to see when she was leaving, if they were going to try to leave. And so they closed the office, and around 8 p.m. is when we saw a bus try to come out of the front doors of ICE. And because we know ICE, and we've been doing this for a long time, we knew it was a decoy. We knew that that wasn't actually the bus that she was going to be coming out of, and it was a distraction. Nonetheless, her children and a lot of folks sat down to block that bus, but we knew that it was probably the other door. So many, many people rushed to the back door where a van was leaving, trying to rush out. And so folks immediately put their bodies in front of that van and in the back of the van so it wouldn't back up, and started chanting. And we could see, we started flashing lights inside of the van and realized that she was in there in the back of the van. And so chanted, rallied around her. And I think more than anything, we wanted to ensure through the live streaming that we were able to get this message out. Right now, we need people to rise up across the country. We saw a beautiful manifestation of this across airports a couple weeks ago. And now is when our people, the people that are considered undeserving, the people that have felony convictions, any type of criminal record, are going to be sought after, whether they're checked in, whether in their homes or in the streets. And so more than anything, we wanted to get it out to the general public. And then we saw yesterday in L.A. people rise up, and we hope that people do this across the country.
Arondios, your wife left Mexico when she was 14 years old. How old are your two children now?
My son Angel is 16, and my daughter Jacqueline is 14.
And can you talk about the effect on you and the effect on them?
Well, first off, Francisca mentioned, we were victims of Arpaio, you know, back in 2008. It is kind of sad to see my son when back in 2008, this was December 16, when Arpaio's officers went to my house. I wasn't there, but it was kind of sad to that my son, when he was around eight years old, he saw how his mom was taken away from him, handcuffed. Now that's traumatizing for a kid that is 8 years old, who doesn't know what is going on. Why is police going into their house and took their mom away? And I mean, it is really frustrating. I mean, we've been suffering a lot, and now we're suffering for Trump. I mean, now we're victims of Trump, and it is really traumatizing for our kids. We think about our kids. We don't think just about ourselves. We think about our kids, and all the is affecting, you know. They're not going to have any trust on police now, you know, because of what is going on right now with police officers, with the sheriff, with ICE. There's not going to be any trust. They're creating fear on our teenagers.
I wanted to go out with your children's voices, who are now with your wife. Guadalupe Garcia's teenage daughter and son reacting to the deportation of their mother.
I'm going to keep on fighting. I'm going to keep on fighting for my mom and for the other families that are going through the same thing, because this is unfair, and it's really sad.
We want her back in our arms. We want her back over here where she belongs. She belongs with us. And we're going to keep on fighting. We're not going to stop.
That is Jacqueline and Angel Garcia talking about their mother and her deportation. I want to thank you both for being with us, Francisca Porchas of Puente, Arizona, and Aron Reyes, husband of Guadalupe Garcia de Reyes. After 21 years, she was just deported to Mexico. This is Democracy Now! When we come back, a Bowling Green massacre? Well, not the one Kellyanne Conway talked about. But what about another one? Stay with us. Thank you.
Swing low, sweet chariot, coming for to carry me home. Swing low, sweet chariot, coming for to carry me home.
Swing low, sweet chariot. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman, as we end today's show with a closer look at the Bowling Green Massacre. No, not the non-existent terrorist attack manufactured by Donald Trump's counselor, Kellyanne Conway, but an actual threat by an extremist in Bowling Green, Ohio. In 2012, an FBI raid uncovered a full arsenal of assault rifles, firearms, body armor and ammunition amassed by the suspect, whom prosecutors later determined was planning to carry out mass killings. But the suspect is not a radical Muslim. He's a white supremacist. His name is Richard Schmidt. Federal authorities say he was planning targeted attacks on African Americans and Jews. Investigators found a list of names and addresses of people to be assassinated, including the leaders of the NAACP chapters in Michigan and Ohio. Schmidt was sentenced to less than 6 years in prison after a federal judge said prosecutors had failed to adequately establish he was a political terrorist. He's scheduled for release next year, February of 2018. Schmidt's case isn't the only one involving terror threats by a white supremacist that received little coverage by mainstream media. On Monday, the trial of Christian minister Robert Daugaard began in Tennessee Federal District Court. Undercover FBI agents alleged Daugaard was plotting to travel to upstate New York to kill Muslims there, using explosives, an M4 assault rifle and a machete. According to a federal investigation, he saw himself as a religious warrior and wanted to kill Muslims to show his commitment to his Christian God. His trial began on the same day the president falsely claimed during a speech to U.S. Central Command at MacDill Air Force Base in Florida that the media is intentionally covering up terrorist attacks.
I've seen what happened in Paris and Nice. All over Europe, it's happening. It's gotten to a point where it's not even being reported. And in many cases, the very, very dishonest press doesn't want to report it.
Well, according to our next guest, the cases that the press is ignoring are not those involving Muslim terrorists, but those of white supremacists and white nationalists committing hate crimes and planning attacks on Muslims, Jews, African Americans and other marginalized communities. In Berkeley, California, A.C. Thompson is with us, a journalist with ProPublica, where he's a team leader for a project that documents hate crimes, bias incidents and racial extremists. He highlighted Richard Schmidt's case in his article, When the Government Really Did Fear a Bowling Green Massacre, from a white supremacist. And joining us here in New York, Dean Obadala is a columnist for The Daily Beast and host of The Dean Obadala Show on Sirius XM Radio, has written several times about Robert Daugaard, most recently the article The Terror Trial We're Really Ignoring. We welcome you both to Democracy Now! A.C. Thompson, let's begin with you. The Bowling Green Massacre that you're writing about.
Yeah, so this was an absolutely incredible incident back in 2012. Richard Schmidt was a guy who had spent years in the Army. He had lost his Army service. He'd been a reservist after his active duty when he got into a street altercation and shot three people. He killed one of them, a man named Anthony Torres, spent 13 years in prison. When he got out of prison, he was banned from owning firearms. Despite that, he amassed a massive, massive arsenal. Assault rifles, shotguns, pistols, 40,000 rounds of ammunition, body armor. The federal government found out about his arsenal basically by accident. They were investigating a counterfeit sports good ring. Schmidt had a business selling sports memorabilia, and they traced packages of counterfeit NFL jerseys to his business in Bowling Green. When they got there, they found something that was much more worrisome than counterfeit goods. They found this huge arsenal owned by a felon who was not allowed to have guns. But more worrisome than that, what they found was a membership card for the National Alliance, a white supremacist group linked to more than 200 murders, and a indication that he was associated with the Vinlanders, a neo-Nazi skinhead group that's active in Ohio and around the country. They believe that he was plotting to kill a series of people in Ohio and Michigan, videotape the killings, and then email them to his fellow white supremacists.
So when you heard about the Bowling Green massacre that Kellyanne Conway was talking about, which in fact didn't exist, that she repeated over and over again in different interviews, your thoughts?
Look, people make mistakes in public speaking. I could make one right now. The important thing is that what's worrisome about the Bush administration, or the Trump administration, excuse me, is that there seems to be this intense focus on one type of terrorism, one type of crime, and that's Islamic radical terrorism. When in fact, we have a whole wave of sort of domestic homegrown terrorists, white supremacists, white nationalists, extreme religious fundamentalists who have been committing crimes in this country for decades. Slate documented nearly 40 of these types of terrorist incidents since the Oklahoma City bombing. And you could make a much, much longer list. In Ohio, around the same time that Mr. Schmidt was going to trial, there was another incident where a gentleman was angry about something he saw on Fox News, went to a mosque in West Toledo, Ohio, set it on fire, did $1.4 million damage to the mosque. And that case, again, is another one that's gotten very little attention.
Dean Obadala, you looked at the list that President Trump put out of the terrorist attacks, all of them Muslim, none of them involving Muslim victims.
Right.
Talk about—
Well, I mean, Donald Trump's whole game plan during the primaries is to gin up fears of Muslims. That was one of the biggest things he used, in addition to ginning up fear of Latinos, Mexicans, immigrants, and demonizing women and disabled. So we're not stunned that, as president, he will continue that game plan of trying to divide our country by saying, look, Muslims are a danger. I've got this Muslim ban, and now I'm going to lie to you and say the only threat out there right now are Muslims. And that's not the reality. The irony, the same day he's talking about that, Robert Dargert trial began in federal court in Tennessee. A man who plotted, per the FBI investigation, to come to New York State to kill Muslims in a community that's primarily African-American Muslim community, started in the 1990s up there. But that's not the only one.
And that trial's going on now.
That trial's right now, it's going on. We're about day four of the trial, day five of the trial. But that's not the only case. We have Glennon Scott Crawford, a man sentenced to 30 years to life in December. For what? For building a radioactive weapon of mass destruction to kill Muslims. The guy was a U.S. Navy veteran and a member of the Ku Klux Klan, another white supremacist. In September, three men called the Crusaders, as in Christian Crusaders, plotting to kill Muslims, Somali refugees in Kansas. Just this week, a man who was a self-professed Trump supporter had burned down a mosque in Orlando, got 30 years to life. It was a hate crime because he had prior convictions. There are people out there who want to kill me. I'm Muslim and my community, simply because of our faith. And Donald Trump does not talk about them at all. We don't matter to him.
And what about Quebec?
And Quebec City, when you had that, you had a man who, again, self-professed, at least a supporter of Trump online, a man who had anti-immigrant views, walked into a mosque, opened fire. When he was done, six Muslims were killed, scores wounded. Donald Trump does not one tweet about that. He tweets more about Nordstrom's than he tweets about these people being killed by a terrorist. Yet he will tweet about a man in Paris who takes a machete out and yells, Allah Akbar, and he tweets, radical Islam, France is afraid of again. Donald Trump, you know, I've been in the Middle East countless times. I've seen what third world dictators do, how they gin up fear and try to create sectarian divides. Donald Trump is mimicking that. You just had, you know, Vince Warren on making that great the same point. I see it another way. It is bone-chilling. It's scary. Our community feels alone right now. Thankfully, though, we have other people standing with us. That's the one good thing, but not this administration. They stand against us.
Is the Justice Department tracking white supremacist attacks?
Well, I assume they're charged to. I don't know how they're going to. They just took the new executive decision to reprioritize allocation of assets. I did have a meeting recently where I was at, and I can't say the name of the person, DOJ, that was the rules. And I said, you know, Loretta Lynch told us that she stands with the Muslim community. Do you stand with us? And he said he's a high-ranking political appointee by Trump because we don't stand with anyone. We stand with the law. And in the context
Five
of my
seconds.
Question, that was bone-chilling.
Dean Obadala and A.C. Thompson, I thank you for being with us. We're going to continue this conversation posted online at democracynow.org. That does it for our broadcast. I'm Amy Goodman. Thanks so much for joining us for another edition of Democracy Now!